you this chance to talk about genetics. It's in fact a fascinating field. I do have some conflicts to disclose, which is that I'm an employee and I have some equity in Corigen. But a personal conflict is that my family and friends wanted me to go to a concert out in California this week, and I had to tell them that I have a conflict. I have to give a presentation about cannabis and sex, of which they both asked, what's the difference and why are you coming with us? It's not in Santa Clara, it's actually in Halifax. And it brings on some very interesting aspects about speaker bias. So I'm a male speaker, and I'm going to be speaking to you about why genetics and cannabis. And I have my own biases, which is that I don't do a very good job reading other people's maps. And that actually paid me a real terrible dividend in this project, because there's great work on how to do this for Mandolino. And it tends to give you these nice banding patterns for male plants, and you can use that to determine whether something is male or female. I arrogantly one day said I could turn this into a qPCR assay in a month, no problem, and as we dug into this, it turned into an onion that just unveiled itself and turned into a year-long project. So what we want to do is turn this into a qPCR assay so that it can be fast, quick, field portable, potentially multiplex, again, with all the benefits of PCR without having to interpret gels. Should be easy, the primers are out there, right? Well, we went and sequenced all of these things, and he even gave us a really nice warning, which is watch out, these things are repeat. And we saw two copies, we said, no problem, there's many autosomes, we don't have to worry about things that are diploid, right? It turns out to be more than two copies, and we should have known that from this work, but we went and sequenced all these products and tried to make sense of them to see if we could find a probe that would go in between the primers for qPCR. You can't just use a CIBR assay when males and females want to make bands. You have to have something that differentiates those bands, and that's usually a tag band primer. So we sequenced a whole male genome as we got tangled in this onion, and when we sequenced this genome to 30x coverage and mapped it against the MADC2 reference sequences, we found that we had 17,000x coverage. So that was a warning sign right there that there's 500 copies of this thing in the genome and they may not all be male specific. The other thing that we noticed was that there are some SNPs that run through these primers, and that could create some interesting artifacts designed in PCR assays. Very few of the reads came back paired, which means they weren't the expected distance apart. That's usually a sign for repeat. We had a couple that were paired. And the other thing that we found is when we looked at the other side of the amplicon, there's actually a SNP right on the 3' end of the primer. For anyone who plays with PCR, that's just a roulette wheel if you're not careful. So that SNP we became very worried about and realized maybe this is the right region to be probing the Y chromosome. Let's see if we can find other regions on the Y. We already had one male sequence. Let's sequence a few more. But before we threw in the towel, we gave it one more try to run a gradient PCR to see. Maybe it's just temperature and we got to find the right TM. And what we found, surprisingly, is as you go to higher temperatures with PCR, we got more bands with this, not less. Usually you get more specific with higher temperatures. So that was really, the nail in the coffin in this thing. Our DNA preps are probably going to have variable salt, or we'll pick up an enzyme, this thing's not going to behave consistently. Let's see if we can find something in the other regions of the Y. At this point, since I said it would take a month, and it was now 3 months in, I got embarrassed to sequence truckloads of plants to try to figure this out. We went 12 females deep on to get ourselves a picture of the XX, and then we found two other males, which are very hard to find, and sequence those as deep as we can. So what you do in this experiment is you take all of the reads that are from the male, and you line them against the females. And the reads that don't align with the females, you then align them as their own assembly. And then you filter those. You filter them to make sure there are no microbial hits, because there are a lot of microbes that grow on cannabis. We have a poster on that tomorrow. And then you also filter them to make sure they have no SNPs, because you don't want to be picking diploid regions if you're looking for Y. And then you also pull out the repeats if you can and find the right GC conditions for good PCR. So we do this. This is a process that we use called an Xterra reaction. It takes 30 nanograms of DNA to make a chocolate library that can be sequenced on Illumina. We make special care to size select these libraries because we want to know the distance between these pairs, and that helps us in the interpretation of the data. And this was actually published by a gentleman named Kagi. They did this on Lotus. They didn't have a reference sequence though to work with, and so what they were doing, they arguably had to use more specimens to get this done. Having the benefit of the Toronto references and some of the other references that we've developed, we were able to do this with much fewer reads. And we just get through about 80 million reads per male. So we used a Wi-Fi male, great stomper male, and an Australian bastard male, which I'm going to talk a little bit more in the next presentation. But about 80 to 90 million reads apiece, they're 250 base pair reads. You map these against females, and you tend to get about 99% mapping. The left over is presumably Y contig, and perhaps some microbiome material. And we've done some preliminary blasts, but haven't done deep in there. What we do look for is that there shouldn't be any hits to hops. because the hops genomes that have been sequenced are female, so if we get anything that's Y putative and it hits hops, we're worried that that's actually a piece of the Y we haven't quite appreciated. And we don't see any of that here, mostly hits to grapes. So when we're done with this, we can design an assay that then gives us a single binary band. One band or no band is what we're looking for, so we can put a probe in there and give us a signal, which is different than having things that give you multiple bands from both male and female. So then we went out and said, all right, we have to multiplex this in order to give us a control. We really want to have an autosomal control in there, and what's that control? We picked a gene in the cannabinoid synthase pathway, which turned out to be a harder project than the actual Y chromosome, because as John McPartland has shown, there's a tenfold more variation in the cannabinoid synthase pathway than there is in the other parts of the genome. So this assay took us rounds of optimization to make sure it didn't hit any SNPs. But the Y comes up as its own blue color in this assay. So you either see SSCG, which we call single copy canvas gene, it's actually diploid, but beyond that, and Y. And if Y doesn't show up, you know it's female, and if the Y does show up, you know it's male. You should always at least see the autosomal and the cannabinoid synthase pathway. So we sequenced 10 out of Maine, 10 out of the Seattle region, those all worked. Another 20 out of the Humboldt County region. And the reason we're doing this is we want geographically diverse specimens because it's a very polymorphic plant. And if you don't do this, you can easily make false assumptions. Assembling all this data together, we had 40 out of 41 males pass this. One male showed no Y signal, but we never actually had pollen sacs. We just had a visual confirmation of the leaf. And we had one female that tested as a male. So this could be a sample swap or we're going down the road of, but we've lined them both up for whole genome sequencing, which was sort of the problem. If we sequence them entirely, we'll know which ones are male or female, and we can correct if there's any acid limitations or if it's just a sample swap. Two flower hermaphrodites also tested as females, which was interesting. This is a process we have ongoing to sequence those two discordant males, which we may have the data by the end of the conference, which is going on Friday. But this is a simple process. We just measure the percent maleness by mapping all of the reads from the genomes of the new sequence against these 2,000 putative male contigs, and the read density will tell us ratio. So then we went deep into the most distant genetics we could find. And this was a clone that was given to us out of a workshop in Seattle. It was known as Australian Bastard Hybrid. It is not the original Australian Bastard clone, but it is one that has been crossed with a sativa. And the reason we wanted to do this is that it was truly a distant strain. We wanted to see if we had evolutionary conserved regions that would also work in that sample. Surprisingly, the cannabinoid synthase gene lined up on it. Also, we have a Y chromosome that's present. This kind of triggered us into a deeper discussion, as once we recognized that this plant had a very different leaf shape and was potentially distant, we said we need to know more about that Y chromosome. So we sequenced the whole thing and see what we get. And that actually leads us into the next presentation that we're going to touch on, is the whole story around sequencing this genome and what it taught us about the complexity of cannabis genetics. There are a few people I want to support and thank for this. We have been privately funded very generously and appreciate every single investor's support and trust in us. There's an entire AgenCore team here. There's some folks in the workshop that helped us and some helpful communications from others in the field with MCR Labs. We've also had some musicians help out. We always love that, and there's popular support for what we're doing. And with that, I think I'll leave it for questions so there's enough time for the next presentation on the Australian Bastard genome story.
Because Kevin's got to do this, we're not going to be able to do questions at the end. So if you don't have questions until the end of the second presentation, you go. Thank you. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, so this is taking that actual Australian Bastard sample, and we wanted to look into whether or not this is putatively different species. I didn't believe it. I saw it in the news, and it sounded like the person who announced that they found this in Australia couldn't be found. So I was naturally skeptical that this actually existed until we went to the workshop, and they presented this to us as something that has a very different leaf shape. Same conflicts of interest exist. But this is it, and it has phylotaxy. It has a different look to it. But is that really a definition of speciation? I know it's been used quite a bit in the cannabis industry to have narrow leaf and broad leaf types of taxonomy, but when you look at the nearest genetic cousin to cannabis, it's hops, which has that different leaf shape. When you look at things that are very distant to cannabis, like Japanese maple, you start to question whether we're really looking at like eye color in the human population, trying to discern Neanderthal from human. It may not be the most precise mechanism for finding speciation. So we believe the right approach is chemotype and genotype connected. When we have both of that, those bits of information, we can begin to make some definitions of these. I will caution, though, that right now, with all of this next-generation sequencing that's going on in the field, the definition of true life is changing. Branches are blurring, and there's lots of debate about viral gene transfer. So I do not believe we can solve this debate today, but we're going to put forward, hopefully, a method to get to the end, to get to the bottom of it. So this strain, as I mentioned before, has been crossed with purple skunk, and that's going to become very important in the discussion because we are trying to ascertain by sequencing this whether we can actually build haplotypes of the purple skunk genome and separate those from the perhaps maternal line that's coming from Australia. And to do that requires some new sequencing technology we're going to go over. But the first and foremost thing is to look at, does this plant that is a hybrid have different cannabinoids? And Cameron Miller at the workshop did all of this work and is a co-author on this, and he's convinced that there are in fact cannabinoids there. He can see trichomes under the microscope, but they're actually a very low in concentration in terms of the amount of the cannabinoids being presented. That's perhaps not too dissimilar from Small's work, because this, remember, is a male plant. So the terpenes, I'm sorry if you can't see those. I think myrcene is probably the most significant one up there that is similar to other strains. But again, there are very low amounts of terpenes. I can afford this for others if they want to dig into the actual terpenes that are there. They're about 30-fold lower than what you'd see in something that is sold in a dispensary called Synex. So those are very low up there. We already went through how this has an X and Y chromosome, or at least a Y chromosome, and we know there's an autosomal thing. This is what really drove us into, okay, sequence this deeper. When you begin to sequence any of these genomes, the way that you map the data becomes incredibly important because there are several cannabis references out there, and they're still in many pieces, and they can be difficult to interpret the data. But we take a very similar approach where we use these transposons to make a library out of 30 to 50 nanograms of DNA. It's very important that we size select that DNA so we know the distances of these 250 base pair reads and how far apart they are. After we're done sequencing, we can then map these two references and make some inferences. Now, the first thing that we saw when we mapped this was that, look, we have homozygous variants over here, but there's heterozygous ones in the middle. Did we map this correctly, or is this a false positive? Luckily, we can go into the literature and look at some of the stuff that was recently put in there from Anofri and from other folks, and see that yes, indeed, if you line all the messenger RNA sequences in GenBank, this one is there. It's not novel, it's been seen before. Our question was, did it really exist in this particular gene or some pseudogene? And that's an important topic. When you map these reads back to the genome, this is what happens when you map them just to the messenger RNA sequences. The mappers tend to collapse all the reads on top of the hypothesis you give it. And so you get hyperpolymorphic regions. If you map it to the entire reference, a lot of those SNPs disappear. This one disappears. This took us a lot of sleuthing to figure out, however, because it's not really evident at a first pass using the method that we sequenced. So here's another reason that confounded us as well. There was a wonderful paper from Anofri that cloned these things and phased them and gave us another picture. A picture that also suggested there could be more than just a diploid status for THC synthase. However, the actual SNPs that we were interested in were underneath those primer sites, so we couldn't use these. In effect, to ask the question whether that SNP was real. That SNP was a signal peptide, so we're very interested in it. And that's just an artifact of having a start code on here. It's an artifact of some of Sanger sequencing. You can't get extraordinarily long reads in Sanger sequencing, so you tend to inch your primers in as close as you can. Nevertheless, we could take this approach and try to build a phasing system off of it that we could use on next generation sequencing. And Sanger sequencers are great because they can get like 8 or 900 base pair reads. You can almost get two reads to come in and touch the center of this 1.7 kb. Gene. You might have some error on the edges and in the middle when you do that. We wanted to use a next-gen system that was more scalable, so we designed a system where we would take this amplicon and make a shotgun library out of it and tightly size it out at 8 or 9 bases. And what that affords you to do is when you have paired reads that are basically 900 bases apart and they're 300 bases or 250 bases long on each side, when you find two or three SNPs in one read, you know that's from one haplotype. When another read lands on there with the same SNPs, it's mate pair. Paired and read is of the same haplotype. And so you can do this haplotype walking with this type of paired system and put together the phase. And that's effectively what we're doing right now with the Illumina system, but it's important that we validate this with something, an orthogonal technology that can confirm phase. And this is where these other next generation sequencers have come into play, is that they allow single molecule sequencing. And single molecule sequencing is very important if you get very long single molecule. So what we do in this case is we take the THC synthase amplicon, we clone it with hairpins for Pacific Biosciences sequencing system, and then we can roll that like in a rolling circle sequencing reaction and read this thing like effectively an RCA reaction that sequences in real time. And so this polymerase moves along and eventually goes around the other side and ends up reading the opposite strand, and you build a circular consensus and on one single molecule to get a phase. And this is very handy because if you don't do this on single molecule sequencers, you have 85% accuracy, you don't know what's going on. But if you put it in one of these things and roll it around and around and around, you get 99.9% accuracy. And you can get really nice 20 laps on the circle to give you really nice accurate data, an outcome really nice phased information very similar to what Mofri published. We do now know that this one down here has a stop codon on it. We're only presenting the amino acid changing variants, not the non-synonymous ones. There's more than presented here. But we now know we're dealing with four, and one's a pseudogene. So that's very helpful. If you want to go back to this Australian bastard sample, knowing it's been crossed with a skunk, you now have to think about it in terms of five genes, maybe two or three coming from one parent, and the other coming from the Australian one, in order to sort this out. So we're just engaging on that now, is running that Australian sample on the single molecule sequencers to get its phase, and that should give us the net results. Now, nevertheless, when you have these phase sequences from PacBio, you then can take all of your Illumina data that we use with that phase method and line it up there, and you should see absolutely no SNPs against those references. And that's what we're starting to see, which is that we can now use the 50-fold cheaper sequencer once we've done some de novo work with the PacBio. And that's what it looks like if you don't do this, basically. We started off with the reads kind of misphased, all collapsing on top of each other, and now have these five perfect haplotypes that we can study. So now let's talk about how different is this. If you take all of these Illumina reads from a whole genome shotgunning experiment, going back to sequencing the entire genome, not just DHC sequences, if you take those and map them against the CanSat references, you start getting some interesting divergence numbers here. We get 94% of the reads that map from the Australian bastard male back to CanSat. Another male known as Wi-Fi is much more than that, Gravestomper much more than that. Map it again with a different algorithm, we get more than that. Use LA Confidential, much more than 94%. Use HEN from John Page's work, we get 97.7%. So clearly this thing is more diverged than hemp, even though it's been crossed with sativa, which is interesting. If you take bonobo and map it to human, which are defined as different species genomically, and from breeding perspectives, maybe not, if you think about some other individuals you might know, maybe they're similar, but it's only 95%. So I think the most important thing to take out of this is not necessarily the mapping rate of these reads, but the properly paired numbers. This is why we're very interested in those tightly selected libraries, because the mapping rates can actually be muddled up by microbiomes, which I'll show in the next slide, but the properly paired rates cannot. These are reads where both reads map, and they should be the same distance and orientation as expected from the way you make the library. And if they're inverted, or if they're too far apart or too close, they represent a structural rearrangement. And the structural rearrangements tend to be more convincing that there's actually a speciation event that's occurred. And you can see up there, there's a lot more of that in this case. We did do some work with humulus, with hops. It's a little harder because the genome has the same N number, it's 2N equals 20, but it's three times the size, so we're only getting 34% to map to that. And I don't know that it gives us a picture of speciation. So we also decided that once we recognized that the microbiome is contributing a little bit to those mapping numbers, that we should go one step further. And this is presented on a poster tomorrow, so I won't spend much time on it here today. But it's a qPCR method that looks for yeast mold and bacteria that we can then sequence. The target's ITS region. So when we sequence this, we can get a microbiome profile. And there was a lot of synonymous action that was sitting on this particular sample. So we then did is tiered up 100 different genomes for reduced representation sequencing to build a phylogenetic tree. And this is where we think it's probably the strongest set of data suggesting this thing is diverged. This was, we're targeting basically about a million discrete loci clamps so that when we sequence them, we get about 70,000 SNPs. And we can use those to then build a phylogenetic tree for this. So it uses restriction enzymes. It's a method called RadSeq. And these restriction enzymes basically cut certain sequences. It's almost like reading the first page in every chapter of a book. You can do it consistently, strain to strain. Such that when you sequence, you don't get whole genome shotgun data, you can get all these nice pileups of sequence on top of each other, strain to strain, and you can get away with using a couple million reads to do this. So you can pile on dozens of strains per sequencing run, and quickly start building out a phylogenetic tree. So this is the tree that we have so far, it's only 50, but what you can see here is Australian bastard in yellow, that's right, it's closest to the hemp lines. There's some nice aspects of the tree in that all of the CBD lines are sitting near the hemp lines. So we've got, I think this one over here is called Otto from Centennial Seeds. This one is CBD Mango Haze. A lot of the hazes all come together, all the pushes come together. We have a couple of replicates out here to make sure those come the same. These two are interestingly sold as different names in Seattle, and we think they're genetically the same. One is WZ, one is Rainbow's Gift. They both have hybrids of CBD and THC. But this is beginning to really take shape so that we can see this as a registry that we can use to track genetics. But I don't think any one sage on stage is going to answer the phylogenetic question of this plant. What we want to build is a Wikipedia that allows the entire community to do it. And we think the best Wikipedia model to do this is based on the distributed consensus algorithms in the Bitcoin blockchain system. This is a system that has millions of computers running every day, every second, competing to build a distributed consensus of a financial ledger. That same ledger can be hijacked to build a distributed consensus of DNA sequence information to build a phylogenetic tree of a plant. That way, we don't need to act like an expert saying we know what the species is. We let the computers decide when a consensus emerges with hundreds of thousands of strains. So we have this going now. There's 29 of the strains, these variant files that are now etched into the Bitcoin blockchain. They're out there replicating on millions of computers. And it's very difficult to turn this thing off now. But we can get plants that are sequenced and submitted to this and open source so that everyone can download the sequence data and compare it with different tools, because I don't think we're going to be the only people who come up with all the tools that we could use on a data set like this. With that, I'm going to leave it with the most controversial slide, which is what is speciation? And Ernst Mayr has one suggesting it does not require crossing, and I don't know if I buy it, but it certainly emphasizes geographically distinct replicating gene pools. In Australia, we can offer that. The question is how long. When did hemp get there? 1800s? Does this thing predate that? We don't know that yet. And I think what we need are the parents. So if anyone knows the parents, we need to sequence those parents and we will figure this out. Otherwise, we're going to be playing these games with phasing to try and understand which allele came from who. And I think it's harder than we think. So with that, I'll leave it with questions.
Nothing else, Kevin gets the prize for the numbers of times the word pasta has been used in the past. We're open to questions.
I had a question about how the genetics were sampled. I mean, were they from a mixture of indoor and outdoor cultivation sites? And how were environmental conditions controlled or possible?
Horribly. It was all done through dispensary access. So there's one reason why I'm not trusting the names on any of these things. I want the genetics to be the picture, because the names are just, we're too many steps away to provide any accuracy.
Another question?
I noticed you used MadCQ, not MadC1. MadC1 was the guideline that was designed for the original paper. And when they ended up doing the live search on that, which is a line-like retrotransposon on that,
they probably do. I mean, that's one of our concerns of the met. We looked at all the mats, 1 through 6, and settled on torture testing 2. Maybe that was the only choice. Any of them, whenever it's a tinmer that's used and amplifies multiple bands, we know we're dealing with a repeat. And that's something that we suspect is less stable. You're not going to find, usually you'll find repeats being highly conserved regions that you can count on being in all the other genetics you run across. So we try to gravitate away from it.
Good work, thank you. Yeah, there was a very smart and technical story to basically answer the question how many types of cannabis are around, right? I think that's a question that keeps a lot of people busy. I work as a head of research at VaderCann, and we have a similar project going on. We call it the Sativa Indica Dilemma. And our approach is to look at it as a patient, because whether it's a tall or small plant or blue or green, or doesn't really matter. It matters what you absorb once you consume it. So we're looking at 48 different components right now. We have a database of 300 samples, just like you have, and we're looking at it in a chemical way to see if it clusters in a certain way. Okay, because I would like to see if your blends are available for chemical extraction and testing, and I would have 300 DNA extracts in the freezer, then perhaps we could combine to a larger question.
Everything we've been doing is off of DNA isolated. The kit that we have, that can, the DNA comes out chemical free, we believe it can go in the mail. So we've been working under that model. We have not touching the plant. We need different laws to make that happen, or partnering with people who have jurisdiction for them to do it.
Just a quick question. Is your DNA extraction method sufficient to disrupt fungal cell wall so that you can then go back and look at the fungal genome?
Yes, and we have, I'm glad you asked that, because we have a whole poster on that tomorrow on all of the different microbiomes we're finding on this. And it's a fascinating story. Some of them are pests of humans, some are pests of plants, and some are even dander related. So it's there's one there.
Question on this side. So for you to invoke a new species, I think you have to think about how did it get to Australia, or is there a wild member of this genus in Australia?
Yes.
I know, you know, we know from Lenny Pine that this could happen, but it seems like quite a stretch to think there's like some sort of value to the new species.
I agree with you 100%, and from the people I've spoken to, this is probably not something that existed in Australia before 1800. It's probably something maybe feral from a hand blood a little bit.
So it's more likely you're looking at this sort of a leaf-shaped mutant with some interesting
cannabinoids. It could have been simply colchicine induced. These things we don't know. There's been lots of hampering of this with mutagens, with the strain in general, the plant, which is in general. So it's not enough time for you to think there could be a speciation that even how quickly cannabis can replicate, but there's a lot of selective pressure in the mutagenesis going on. I think that is probably the source.
Thank you.